Good afternoon and welcome to our closing session of this conference. I want to begin before introducing our third keynote address. I want to begin by reiterating a few things that I began with, in particular, some thanks to Oren Weinberg, David Bloomberg, and Aviad Stolman, the senior administration at the National Library, who have already for this third time envisioned and given backing to this international conference. And this is my second conference that I'm participating in, and the sense of professional acquaintances and professional comradeship and the sense of collective purpose that have been developed at these conferences, at other meetings, I think are something that is important to our collective work. In particular this year, the progress that has been made in the last few days on the Latin American Jewish Archives Network has really been dramatic. I also would like, in particular, to thank Aviva Zeller and Michal Greenwald, who were responsible They really do deserve this, because everything has run like clockwork, and that would not have happened without them. The most exciting thing that has happened in the life of the National Library of Israel since we last convened was the groundbreaking ceremony of our new building, and the tractors are at work as we speak. And before I introduce our speaker, our first speaker, the plan for this last session is that we will have a keynote address from Bruno Racine, who I will introduce shortly, and after that, some closing remarks from the academic director of the National Library, Professor Elchanan Reiner. But I do want to share some of our sense of enthusiasm about the groundbreaking ceremony of the new building with a video that kind of sums up some of the work that has been happening.
What's special about the Islam Middle East collection is that it enables us to understand and learn and to assimilate the ideas of the region that we live in. And it's an opportunity for us to go beyond the Jewish world and to understand the connections between the Jewish and Islamic worlds.
דרכו של הלימוד היהודי המסורתי הייתה ברעש, והלימוד בתנועה ורעש מאפיינת את הלימוד היהודי. להבדיל מהתנועה הזאת, הספרנית הזאת של שקט, דממה מוחלטת, אנחנו צריכים למצוא את האיזון בין השניים.
הרבה פעמים שואלים אותי, מהו הפריט שעדיין חסר לך? התשובה האמיתית מבחינתי היא שכל פריט ופריט, והספרייה הלאומית מוסיפה מאות אלפי פריטים בכל שנה ושנה, אני מרגיש שזה איזשהו קיר שאנחנו נדבך אחר נדבך בסיפור של העם היהודי ומדינת ישראל.
תהליך דיגיטלי של שימור, עיבוד וסריקה ומונגשים להמונים.
למרות אלפי ספרים, מפות וכתבי יד, דרך חומרי שמע, פריטי ארכיון יוצאי דופן, וכלה באוספים נדירים. הכל נחשף והופך נגיש מדי יום למיליוני אנשים ברחבי העולם. בניין הספרייה החדש ייבנה בקריית הלאום בירושלים, מול בניין הכנסת ובסמוך למוזיאון ישראל. המבקרים במשכן החדש יענו משש קומות של אולמות קריאה מתקדמים, מתחם תרבות וחינוך מגוון ומרכז מבקרים משוכלל.
האתגר הגדול שלנו בבניין החדש זה איך לתכנן בניין שיהיה מתאים למגוון של פעילויות בו זמנית. גם לתת את הסביבה האקדמית הלאומיה, את השקט הלאומי, להכיל מבקרים, ליצור פה פעילות תרבותית ולא לפגוע בסביבה הלאומיה של החוקרים.
The building reflects the history, and the history is reflected in the building. It's literally carved out like a piece of stone, like a book that you open. The circle is, of course, bringing daylight in. But the circle continues its way down to the sea of books, where the books are stored. So it's like a water pond, like a well. So it's related even to history. You find water. The concept or the plan for the new library is the countries to open, to welcome, to be transparent, to bring in as much as possible of different kinds of people. The new building that make people happy. That is a place that people want to go. They want to be at that new place because it's part of their heart.
I know what it means for Israeli people. I know what it means also to the world. So it's not only a Jewish project. I think, from my point of view, it's a project that goes beyond that.
עם פתיחתו של המבנה החדש תימשך הפעילות התרבותית העשירה המביאה לספרייה קהלים רחבים. במקביל תימשך פעילות המחקר, השימור וההנגשה של התרבות היהודית והישראלית באמצעים הטכנולוגיים המתקדמים ביותר. זאת כדי לשמור על מעמדה של הספרייה הלאומית כמוסד המוביל בארץ ובעולם באיסוף ובשימור של אוצרות העם היהודי בישראל ובתפוצות.
So we are very excited about what's happening. We are also very excited that Bruno Racine has agreed to travel and deliver this keynote address at the closing session. It is wonderful when libraries, national libraries in particular, can bring not only good content people and good librarians, but people from outside the library world who know how to get things done in the real world. And that's, I think, part of what Mr. Racine brings to the table, because his familiarity not only with the National Library of France, the Bibliothèque Nationale, but in government offices, in other roles in the government, really indicates how necessary it is to bring in people who get things done, not only in the narrow sense of libraries and intellectual content, but in a much broader sense than that. Mr. Racine is going to be speaking to us about a topic that has really hovered over all of our conversations, which is what is the best digital strategy for libraries and memory institutions. Of all the options that we've talked about, analog, digital, open data, top-down, bottom-up, from all of the options that we've been talking about over the last 3 days, how do you pick the right strategy in a complex and changing environment?
Thank you very much. I have to say that I'm very honored by this invitation to speak at the National Library of Israel at the moment when it's going to open such a new and exciting page of its history. I would like particularly to thank Oren Weinberg for this invitation. A few days before I left the BNF, early April, we signed an agreement between the two libraries. And thanks to this agreement, which is going to be implemented shortly, the the digitization of a significant part of the Hebrew manuscript collection of the BNF is going to take place. And in the room, there is Laurent Richet, the curator of the of this very important collection. By the way, it's also, and for my wife as well, our first visit to Jerusalem. So it's a very emotional moment. So I'm not myself a specialist of Judaica. I'm not even a librarian. I will deal with perhaps a more general issue, not necessarily the best digital strategy, but I will talk about digital strategy because I found out that in particular for journalists or politicians, and in this case of the letter, it's very important in terms of funding. Digital strategy means a very simple operation, which is scanning books or manuscripts, right? And it don't realize that, in fact, it's a much broader issue than the simple technical operation, after which you can do away with the physical object and place them in remote location. So I will, of course, dwell on my own experience as a chief executive of the BNF for 9 years, but in that capacity as well, I was involved in more cooperative endeavors. I chaired the Conference of European National Librarians, and I was also the chair of the board of Europeana, the European Digital Library. And I'm going to have a very, in the second part of my talk, European focus for that reasons. But I'm sure that the lessons we can draw from this experience can, mutatis mutandis, apply to other contexts. In the first place, I would perhaps try to put the question of digital strategy in the French case in perspective, because although this is a relatively new concept, it has already an history. 20 or 25 years ago, it's amusing to recall that President Mitterrand, who in fact loved books, promoted a kind of visionary idea. The idea was to build to have a new building, but not that large, and on the other hand, a large digital online strategy. In fact, we did exactly the opposite, as a very large building, very expensive to manage, but which is now a landmark in Paris. And at the opening of the library, there was quite a limited digital library. But there is an excuse or a reason for that, because 20 or 25 years ago, I think the technology was not really mature enough. The old Bibliothèque Nationale was desperately short of space, so we needed to build something not too small. But this is the reality towards which the libraries now are tending. So I could say that from the mid-90s to 2005, the guiding concept for digitization was, in French we say la bibliothèque de l'honnête homme, which is not translatable into English. L'honnête homme is the man who is not a specialist but who is curious of everything. So it's essentially it was anthological. For each discipline, the librarians selected the works which were more or less recognized by posterity. That meant the figure was put forward, 100,000 books, symbolic, of course. And that meant that every year the library, the BNF, digitized 5,000 to 8,000 books. So not a very, not an industrial process, at least. When Google launched its Google Book projects in 2005 with the goal of digitizing every book printed since Gutenberg, the BNF had to... this changed the global picture, of course, because for the first time, given the billions of dollars Google was able to invest in such a project, this utopia could become a reality, could be turned into a reality, or approximately into a reality. So the BNF made a fundamental shift from this model to a new paradigm, in which I would say exhaustivity is the not necessarily the practical goal, but conceptually is the ultimate goal. And in practical terms, that meant changing the pace of digitization of books by a factor of 10, so not 8,000 but 80,000 or 100,000 books or periodicals per year. And instead of selecting the works on the basis of their intrinsic value as the librarians established, the process was exactly the opposite. Let's say, if we decided, for instance, to digitize French poetry or French history, for instance, instead of choosing the good books or the... it was a process based on an elimination, based on objective facts, for instance, the books under copyright, because we had not negotiated with the publishers the right to do... Well, we could digitize them and couldn't legally put them online. So no books under copyright, normally no books read in foreign languages, or books which were not fit for digitization because their physical condition was too big or the format too large, etc. So in other words, any book per se is entitled to being digitized. But that applied for bureaucratic reasons, in part for bureaucratic reasons, but Google Books was about books. So the BNF at the beginning had a focus on printed books. But I thought in the first, the process became industrial in 2008. The contracts were signed in 2007. Almost when I entered into office, and took some months to become a reality. But in 2009, two years after, I thought that, given the richness of our collections, this had to be extended to what we call the special collections in librarian jargon. There was a difficulty, because that's why I mentioned bureaucratic reasons. We had special subsidies for digitization from a public entity called Centre National du Livre. Therefore, it was meant for digitizing books and not other materials. So we had to find complementary resources to engage in a more systematic process of digitization of our special collections. But now the figures are here, almost 8 or 9 years after this change. We have on Gallica, our digital library, more than 4 million documents, not all from the BNF. I will come back from this, including 700,000 books, almost 700,000. But at the beginning, the concept was rather general, and we had to refine it over the last years. And one effort I would like to underline is that we had to try to identify more relevant corpuses within the mass of the millions of books or of items, to identify relevant corpuses. In other words, the challenge here, and I think it's common to every cultural institution, heritage institution, is to find a balance between mass and selection. When I said that the process had become industrial and there was no selection of the value, I have to qualify that in the sense I've just mentioned. And also, the idea was to have a stronger emphasis on the documents that only the BNF possesses, the unica, or in terms of individual items or collections. But the other, but in any case, what I said, that the exhaustivity remains the ultimate horizon, so to speak, of the strategy, remains valid. But on the other hand, we had, and this has been, I think, a very important development. We have tried to implement a cooperative policy. In 2008, I was tasked by the Minister of Culture of the time to propose a policy framework to cover all French libraries, at least those which possess some heritage collections, whether they be university libraries, city libraries, or even private ones, such as the Alliance Israélite Universelle, but there are other examples of very rich and unique private libraries with unique collections. The idea was obvious. We wanted to avoid unnecessary duplications, but on the other hand, also the goal was to avoid unacceptable gaps, because although the BNF is very rich, it's not far from being 100% of the heritage. Another important element in this policy was, so to speak, educational, if I may say so, because the institutions, in particular smaller ones or those with poorer resources, have to understand all the many requirements which are involved in the digital strategy, which again is not limited to mere scanning. Scanning, if there is no correct description of the items, is absolutely useless. It's a waste of waste money. Looking at the picture, at the French picture globally, the Ministry of Culture and ourselves found out that many libraries were in fact lagging behind in terms of cataloging or description of their heritage collections, and this had to be corrected as a matter of priority. So in the wake of this plan, I proposed to the ministry, the BNF got extra funding to enable those libraries who needed to improve, to upgrade their tools to do so. So the referencing of their historical collection was absolutely necessary. And in addition to that, we were able to launch digitization programs at a national scale in a number of identified areas. I could mention, for instance, art history, medicine, law, and the number is increasing, so that in Gallica you find in these areas many books or periodicals or documents, whatever they are, which are in fact in other libraries than the BNF. So Gallica, which was started at the digital library of the National Library, has become over time a French digital library. But there's much work to be done ahead. So I can't go into detail about all the aspects of this policy, but some are very crucial. I have to mention them. First of all, it was the long-term preservation. We know that digital data are very fragile, they can perish very easily. And by the way, when the BNF started its digitization in the 90s, the lifetime of the support was shorter than the program itself. So we have invested a lot of money to build, and we couldn't rely only on a commercial offer for long-term preservation of the national heritage. So we had to build a safe and reliable system, but it's open to partners so that they don't have to pay to engage in difficult and costly programs of preservation. We can also, that's a service we have created not so long ago, we can offer to our partner libraries the management of their own digital library. A good example of that is the digital library of the library of Strasbourg University, which is the second or third largest in France. So we operate the digital library. When you don't see when you are on their site that you are on the technical infrastructure of the BNF. It's completely customized, so to speak. But they can put into their own digital library the items of the BNF which are of interest to them, so it enriches their own digital library, and of course for them it's a marginal cost, and of course also they benefit automatically of any improvement in the infrastructure. So that just to remind that as a national library we have this obligation to share our progress we make in these areas as much as possible, at least at the national level. That being said, what do we want to digitize? Even given that digitizing tens of millions of items in our collections is somewhat of a dream, and the answer to that question is not easy. First of all, there is the question of the national heritage. According to our founding decree, this is the priority, of course. But what does that mean? Let's take the example of the Persian or Arabic or Ottoman manuscript, which were purchased by Francis I in the 16th century or Louis XIV in the 17th. Certainly, their content doesn't belong to our civilization, but the fact that the kings were curious of them and wanted to buy them for their own library tells something about our own culture. And at least it's a universalist aspiration, let's say, dimension. So three or four centuries after they entered into the royal library, they are really part of our heritage, without losing their foreign, so to speak, character. So I'm just to recall, this is obvious, and but when we discuss what is Jewish heritage, I think there is the same dilemma or interrogation. It's a hybrid. This concept of national heritage is hybrid, and certainly based on the idea of purity. But I could. This applies as to the print collection as well, which was started in 17th century, and the king's library had Dutch, Italian, German prints, not only because they were masterpieces in themselves, because they were a source of inspiration for and of education for the French artists of the time. So again, we have this hybrid character. I would say the same for the many archaeological items the BNF possesses. In fact, the first archaeological museum in France, before the Louvre, in the 18th century, was the Royal Library. And I come back to the digital strategy. We have been able to digitize the entire collection of Greek coins, for instance, which is, I think, the second largest in the world, and we are doing the same with the Roman coins. We think it's part of national heritage, although most of them were found elsewhere than in France. But because when they entered the royal the cabinet des médailles, it was called cabinet du roi, they provide much information about ancient history, and ancient history was a fundamental dimension of the education and culture of the time. But the most difficult issue is perhaps about the language. Of course, there are several languages spoken in France, but I don't want to speak of Basque or Alsatian, etc. But the French language itself, and the geographical extension of the French language has never coincided with the boundaries of France. And how do we consider collection in French belonging to French or to non-French speaking countries? You know, the case of very rich countries like Switzerland, Canada, or Luxembourg, Belgium, of course, we don't have to care too much about them, although some of their writers sometimes came to France or lived in France, and we have their manuscripts. But to give the question was raised some years ago when we had the opportunity to purchase the memoirs of Casanova. Casanova was born in Venice. He traveled throughout Europe all his life. He died in a castle which is now in the Czech Republic. His manuscripts were purchased by a German publisher in the 19th century, and 8 years ago, the descendant of this publisher came to me and said, it's written in French, so it should be interesting for you, and indeed we decided to buy it. But in fact, it would be more be fairer to speak of European heritage written in French in this case. Give another example. There used to be a very important and thriving Francophone press in the Middle East, in the Levant, since French was the communication language in the region in 19th century and first half of the 20th century. And to start with, we have digitized the Francophone press of the Ottoman Empire in the context, and this is interesting, of a partnership with the French Research Center, which is based in Turkey. And why do we do so? Because of the language, on the one hand, because we assume that the users of Gallica understand French, and it would be logical place to have those digital newspapers, but also because for Turkish institutions, it couldn't be a priority for them. So as it's often said, now when something is not digital, it tends to be non-existent for a younger generation of researchers. So, drawing the boundaries of national heritage for a country like France, like for Britain, for instance, who had a vast colonial empire and global use of the language, is an issue which can be resolved only on the basis of a pragmatic approach. Second question, what types of documents do we have to digitize? I recall that the Google project was focused only on books. It is already a big challenge. It's a strength in the sense that it enabled Google to put in place a very effective industrial process. In a few years, a million of books have been digitized. It enables other institutions not to duplicate unnecessarily some of the work they have done, but it's also a limit which creates opportunities for others. That's why I thought that the digitization of special collections, manuscripts, photographs, prints, maps, musical scores, sound and audiovisual documents was also had to become also a priority. But again, given the mass of those collections, we have to identify relevant corpuses to have the balance I recommended between mass and selection. Finally, there is the question of books protected by copyright or whatever. It's a very sensitive issue, as you know. The BNF is entitled for preservation motives to digitize any book published in published in France, but we are not allowed to put them online. So there were many disputes, in particular the cases between Google and the publishers throughout the world. Usually those disputes end up with a settlement in which Google compensates more or less for the loss or revenue. The problem we have is that our traditional catalog doesn't provide us with all the information required to establish the right status. We don't have always all the authors or contributors in case of collective works. The date of death in France, if you were killed in action in war, there is a prolongation. So this information is not usually in the catalog, and there is a kind of gray area. So far, we have digitized books up to the BNF, as you shouldn't say we anymore, but you will pardon me if I have this lapsus again. Up to 1920, we didn't have any incident, but it is very likely that in the mass which is now available in Gallica, there are still books, there are books still under copyright, but whose right holders probably have vanished, who don't exist any longer. Of course, when we can get the agreement of rights holder, this is particularly true for periodicals, we can put them online, digitize them and put them online. Usually there is a reviews older than 10 years are easily on free access on the web because they don't have any commercial value any longer. This subject has been very important in the discussion at the European level. This idea that the digital library, in contrast with the physical one, has a black hole for the 20th century, has become a real issue. And the European Commission has published a directive on the subject. But a few months earlier, France had passed a law on the subject which regards all books which are, the technical term is commercially unavailable, usually what we call out of print, more or less, not exactly the same, but almost the same. While the Commission focused more on orphan works, which is part of the problem, but not the whole problem. The books commercially unavailable is more, much broader scope. It's quite complicated. I don't elaborate too much on that. But the National Library of France has a role to play in this project. First of all, we have to establish the register of those works, so that we have to look for, search those information which we don't have in our catalog, so that we can establish the right status of the books. And when this register is published, actually every year we publish about 60,000 titles, the rights holders can say we want to opt out of the system. Okay, we have this register, and we digitize the books themselves. They are on Gallica, but being again commercially available, what you can find on Gallica is only 15% in free access, 50% of the books. But it gave a second life to already to thousands of books of the 20th century who were no longer available. The goal is to digitize perhaps 250,000 books in the next 3 or 4 years. So it's a significant corpus. A question we have, which was touched upon some discussions of it, it's a crucial one, is the money. It's very exciting to have ambitious goals, and how do we achieve that? In the case of the PNF, first of all, we have been able to count on public subsidies. That has been absolutely essential. And every year, the BNF since 2008 got, it's not that much, but it's very significant. There was a guarantee that we would get them over time, about 6 million euros per year. Part of it served to build the long-term preservation and the development of Gallica, but more than half of it was dedicated to the digitization of books of periodicals. So this guarantee of public funding enables an institution to have a long-term strategy instead of a case-by-case or picking up opportunities. In an effort also to support the universities, the French government gave them at times very significant sums of money for research programs, collective programs, which often comprise a digitization dimension. And this has strengthened the link, the relation between the BNF and some universities. This is very interesting because in this case, digitization is closely associated with very interesting academic programs. So they combine scholarly expertise on the one hand, free access to the general public on the other hand. There's also another source of public funding, which I'll mention. I'll come back to them later, which is European funding. Then, which is not public, is private, and private funding falls into two big categories, in fact. Non-profit, on the one hand, commercial on the other. Non-profit organization, mostly foundations, can be national or foreign, who are very often, and this is a very exciting opportunity, interested in multinational programs. To give a first example, the Mellon Foundation, an American one, funded the digitization of the Roman de la Rose, bestseller of the Middle Age. We are going to start quite a big digitization program of concerning medieval illuminated medieval manuscript with the British Library, supported by a London-based foundation. And of course, in this case, there is a discussion or with the funding partner. So it's very much dependent on their own priorities, and we try to make their priorities and ours converge or coincide. Then you have the public-private partnership, or let's say partnership with commercial institutions, and there are different models here. The best known is, of course, the Google model, in which Google covers all the costs of digitization and gets in return an exclusive right of to exploit commercially the files for 20 or 25 years or so. But for the user, one has to say that the result is much the same as with the non-profit organization, because it's free access online. And there are other types of partnerships which with commercial partners, which entail, which are associated with more restrictive conditions for access, at least during a certain period of time, from 7 to 10 years, so the private partner can recoup the cost of their investment. So on this area, the European Commission has set out a number of recommendations to ensure that this kind of agreement remains compatible with the general interest. And we have used the BNF has used this type of partnership through a subsidiary which was created for the for that purpose. Otherwise, we would have had legal problems. And this will allow quicker and more substantial digitization of collections such as newspapers, books prior to the 17th century, and sound collections. Some of them, sound collections, requiring skills, technical skills, research and development that we wouldn't have been able to do by ourselves. So when you combine all these sources of financing, you can really implement a comprehensive strategy with industrial scale, but also more targeted programs, highly curated ones on certain themes or corpuses. But again, I would insist on the fact that without a guarantee of regular public subsidy, you have to look for opportunities. It's more difficult to have your own priorities taken into account. So sorry if I ramble a little, but as I said, I often hear that digital strategy is something very, very, very simple, and I haven't talked about, and I won't have time to talk about the problems regarding the physical preservation of the collection which have been digitized. When in some libraries, when newspapers were microfilmed, they were destroyed afterward. This is a mistake which we try not to repeat. Of course, for manuscript, there is no risk that we are going to destroy them after the digitization. But do we keep them at the same place? Can we store them in more remote storage facilities? So this has an impact on the way the physical building, which is going to remain, is used, offers proper services to the researchers. So this is also, a consequence of digitization in terms of physical preservation. And I should add also that in some cases, a work of conservation is required prior to digitization to have the best quality possible afterwards. I've not touched upon a very important issue, and I think one of the most important: how do cultural institutions of various nature work together in the digital era? Boundaries are blurred, and sometimes they can be abolished. The collections of the French National Library are also, for a large part of them, of museum type. The museum also have prints. We have prints or photographs, and they have illuminated. The Louvre has not many manuscripts, but illuminated pages of manuscript. So, in fact, in the archives, collection. In fact, the administrative divisions, in fact, are questioned by what the digital era can bring about. This is obviously one of the main issues we have to face also at the European level, in an international context. I've mentioned the programs with the British Library, the one that we are going to start with the National Library of Israel, but we have put in place several programs of shared digitization with China, with Japan, Quebec, etc. But I'm going to focus more on Europe, because of my experience for 7 years as chairman of the board of Europeana. So during all this period, I've been closely involved in the consultation with the initiatives undertaken at European level. When Google launched its project, I think it came as a wake-up call for Europe, and the European Commission became conscious that there was a problem which needed to be addressed. Six countries, including France, asked the European Commission really to tackle the subject and to come up with a concrete policy. This was the background for the creation of Europeana 2008 in the form of a Dutch registered foundation based in The Hague. So 8 years ago, a Comité des Sages was set up, which released a report called The New Renaissance, a little bombastic, but useful document nevertheless. The Commission made a recommendation on the digitization in 2011, the European Council in 2012. Guidelines were published in 2014, and the present Commission made the digital single market one of its priorities. Of course, there are other problems arising at the moment in Europe, but I wanted to remind that this problem of a digital digitization of European heritage had not been ignored by the Union. The starting point was, as I said, the Google project. And the comparison with Google was both an opportunity, because competition is stimulating, but it was also a trap, because the conditions, the requirements, the funding was not, the objectives were quite different. So it was a little misleading, but for a long time, still today, the success of Europeana is measured by the number of items which are accessible through the portal. I don't know the figure today, but it must be more than 40 million. This is a very impressive figure indeed, but it shouldn't hide a reality which is perhaps more mixed in terms of success And in particular, the number of hits, the number of visits from the beginning has been rather disappointing. But to make a fair judgment, first of all, one should remember that for the European Commission, the funding, the financing of digitization should be provided not by the Union, but by the member states. So it depends very much on what the various national governments are prepared to do in that area. And Europe, with a few exceptions, too rare in my, from my point of view, doesn't have to finance digitization programs. So Europeana, in fact, is dependent on the quality and the quantity of data provided by the various states and providers, content providers. The consequence of this principle, this policy by the European Commission, is that there is nothing like a global strategy at the European level. It's a piecemeal, like a mosaic strategy, nothing which could be compared to what we are tried to do in France in a more coordinated way. There is no priority, no... five more minutes. Oh, okay. I'm all right. I'm not far from the end. In other words, Europeana tends to be mostly a vast reservoir of data with little organization. That's why the experience of the user is not very much satisfactory. But in spite of all those shortcomings, credit must be given to Europeana for some achievements, which personally I think are remarkable. The first of these is not very visible, but it's vitally important because it's the basis of everything. Europeana has set a standard format for which has enabled the various national digitization policies to be mutually compatible and to aggregate a considerable mass of content. And these standards can to be applied outside Europe. The second is to have been a major player in the opening of data by getting the thousands of content providers to agree to place the metadata, at least, under a free license so that they can be reused in a wide range of services or apps. The third achievement, I think, is to have been able to attach to almost all the contents a right statement, which is also necessary for third parties to be aware of what kind of reuse they are entitled to. A fourth achievement is to have made very significant advances in technology through collective research and development projects, for instance, in the exploitation of digitized newspapers, the preservation of and the access to sound collection, for instance, European newspapers, Europeana sounds have been very the added value has been very, very important. And the last, although insufficiently from my point of view, is to have inspired a few multinational digitization programs, such as, for instance, Europeana Regia, which is a collection of royal manuscripts, collections 1418 in the context of the celebration of the First World War. This program being very interesting because associated with an appeal to the public to bring forward the material they had in their families. And in France, we had 100 collecting points organized by the BNF and the National Archives. It was a huge popular success. In this context, Europeana now seems, so far, Europeana seemed to be seen by the Commission rather than a technological, more than a cultural progress. I think this is going to change because Otherwise, the result will be disappointing. So I have to cut short, but I think the strategy we wanted to set up at Europeana could be summed up in three words. Principle: the material must be usable. That means reusable. In that sense, culture or cultural heritage becomes a catalyst for change, for social and economic change. Otherwise, it's confined to the academic public of the libraries. Second is mutual. We want it to be a real network of connected institutions, and reliable, because in the digital world, the question of reliability is absolutely crucial. So Europe has to improve data quality, open the data, and create value. I don't dwell on this, but if there are questions, I would like to. I would be delighted to answer. So just to as a conclusion, Europeana, what we have tried to do at the national level, means that a digital strategy is unavoidably a collective one. No single institution, even the Library of Congress, even the largest ones, can have a satisfactory strategy if it's not part of a much broader network. And when we signed with Oren this agreement, that meant that the BNF entered into a network whose leadership is assured by the National Library of Israel. Leadership doesn't mean a hierarchy, but there is an institution which is responsible and in which plays the role of the catalyst for this kind of project. And I think in a period which is fraught with so many conflicts, rivalries of all sorts, it's good that cultural institutions underline that, at least in their field, resources are to be shared. Thank you very much.
Last but certainly not least, I would like to invite Professor Elchanan Reiner, the Academic Director of the National Library of Israel, who has recently joined our staff and our team after having been a supporter on the sides for quite some time. And what he's really brought to our staff is a real intellectual and academic excellence that is informed by the needs of contemporary researchers and a vast knowledge of the material, particularly book history. And what Professor Reiner would like to sum up, and this ties in nicely with Mr. Racine's talk about the global situation, about national identity and national culture, are questions of the role of the National Library as the National Library of the State of Israel, of the Jewish people, in the context of the complicated reality we live in.
Part of the staff of the National Library, a place that I spent a lot of days and hours since I was a student, or Bahur Yeshiva Bahur, student, and then scholar and teachers that send his students to this place, and now I'm here again, I'm very proud about it. I'm going to take you far away from the place that Bruno spoke about, to Jerusalem, to Israel, to this house, or at least to this institution, and try to check or to analyze the term national in this context, the National Library of Israel. What is national about the National Library? This question, which seems like a clever witticism, challenges us to understand the basic idea of a National Library in general, perhaps even alluding to its internal contradictions, and also forces us to grapple with the specific identity of the Jewish Israeli National Library in Jerusalem. The idea of the Jewish National Library was first articulated in 1890s by a group of Jewish intellectuals, mainly from Eastern Europe, as an expression of the fledgling and mainly secular Jewish national renewal movement. As is well known, the most prominent member of this group was Dr. Joseph Chazanovich, a physician from Bialystok, who not only formulated the idea of the Jerusalem Library, but also took action. He donated his own library and dedicated the rest of his life to promoting the idea by various means, and that would gave him the title, the founder of the National Library. The development of a library is a long process, but the declaration that a library is a national library is a one-time, conscious, and fundamentally political move. European national libraries are manifestations of the national idea that developed through the 19th century. They are meant to express the cultural uniqueness of the public that lives in the social, political, religious, and cultural sphere that is related to the library's nationality. The establishment of the library in Jerusalem during the last decade of the 19th century was likewise intended to express the uniqueness of Jewish culture and symbolize whatever a national library is meant to symbolize for the public it represents. Yet the idealistic, ideological, almost messianic decision to build the library in Jerusalem, the center of the Jewish people's symbolic, imagined space, far from the actual center, where the group that viewed itself as part of the Jewish nation in the secular sense actually lived, had a profound impact on the library and its future. Not only did the vast majority of the public for whom the library was meant to be national live nowhere near it, but those who actually used the library did not view it as a national library. And those who viewed it as a national library, did not use it. It is possible that this ambivalence kept our initial question, what is national, about the National Library, open for much longer. The question was finally resolved unintentionally, unknowingly, and without any real attempt to grapple with the question during the years 1920 and 1935, the formative years of the library's history, when it was directed and shaped by its first director, the influential philosopher Samuel Hugo Bergman. In those years, during the third Aliyah and subsequent waves of immigration, Palestine gradually became a Jewish Zionist, primarily secular center, for which Jerusalem was, in certain respect, a cultural center, even though most of the Jewish population lived outside Jerusalem. In those years, the library passed into the hands of the Zionist organization, which was then preparing to open the Hebrew University. The result was that the library was redefined not only as a national library, but as a university library as well, with all that implies, including the internal contradictions entailed by combining these two functions into one. During those years, those Zionist efforts were directed primarily at establishing and reinforced the Jewish center in Palestine, and so the library became a hybrid creature. A university library on one hand, and an open public library from the Jews of Eretz Israel on the other. The question of nationality was not addressed in itself. Its national character was seen as a byproduct of the library's two other functions. Perhaps its status as a Jewish public library was interpreted in national terms, though the nationality in question was relatively limited, Eretz Israeli, not pan-Jewish. The precise definition of the national whose culture the library was to be collecting was not very relevant during the British Mandate period. Even as the state was established, it was not easy to set clear parameters on this issue. Yet, as time passed, Israel's self-image as a democratic state made it ironically beneficial to avoid defining the nation whose culture its national library has to preserve. It was easier to ignore the question, what are the boundaries and parameters of this nation? Addressing this question would likely have exposed rifts in Israeli society, but they were not exposed. The question was not asked at all. Nevertheless, the library gradually became much more of a university library and less of national library over the years. The separation of the library from the Hebrew University in the year 2007, alongside the passage of the National Library Act, which determined that, I quote, the National Library shall be an independent organization whose goals are the collection, preservation, and cultivation of the storehouses of knowledge of the State of Israel and the Jewish people in particular, end of quotation. This act was a watershed moment in the history of the library in many respects, including with our question. It seems that the definition we seek was enshrined in the law itself. Nevertheless, it is clear that there is some space between the two overlapping but distinct identities mentioned in the law, the State of Israel with all its citizens, and the diaspora of the Jewish people. That challenge remains somewhat unresolved. Still, there is no doubt that the application of the law to the boundaries of the State of Israel was a significant breakthrough. The library's policy insists on documenting anyone who lives within the boundaries of the state, including all its minorities, and especially the large Arab minority. The nation is now indeed Israeli. The sharp change in the library's status turned out to be much more significant than the fact that it was severed from the Hebrew University, and that change was a real challenge to the library. In many respects, it was only now that the National Library truly became, for the first time in its existence, a national library. It had to deal with the new challenges from top to bottom, unable to rely on long tradition, even though it was over 100 years old by that time. At first glance, there is an inherent, intractable contradictions in how the National Library relates to the two spheres of its nationality, that of multicultural, multinational, and fundamentally polarized Israel, whose borders operates, alongside the seemingly mononational sphere of the Jewish diaspora, which lies beyond the immediate horizon. The library chose to deal with its status as a national library with obligations toward the Israeli society as well as the Jewish diaspora, which views it as its symbolic center by operating with two spheres at once. The Jewish sphere, fulfilling its traditional role as a library of the Jewish people to an unparalleled degree, and the Israeli sphere, in which it fulfills its role with respect to the Israeli nation within the borders of the state, the borders of that nation. Thus, the library expresses its awareness of the great challenge it undertook when it was defined as a national library, and thus it was expressed in the collections policy guidelines, which was articulated anew to reflect the aforementioned changes in the National Library. In context of Israeli current struggle over its definitional narrative, the National Library's duty is to collect everything, preserve everything, and make everything equally accessible. This gives the library an exceedingly important role in the struggle to preserve Israeli democracy. This, in many respects, is a duty, the privilege, and the mission of the National Library today. Thank you very much.
To two things that connect the two lectures that we just heard, and then I'll open the floor to questions before we say our final teary-eyed goodbyes. The first thing I wanted to point out is a commonality between the two lectures that raise an important issue that could be overstated, but I think should not be overstated, and that is that collection, in addition to being an academic act, is also a political act. And our collection policies are collection policies that work to build, that come out of existing national or religious or cultural identities, and then the institutions that collect are designed to help promote and educate toward those kinds of identities. And these questions end up, turns out that academics and culture and politics of nations end up becoming tied up with one another, and we shouldn't lose track of that. The second thing that I think connects these two lectures together is the relationship between the academic, abstract, almost philosophical perspective on library work that Professor Reiner suggests, as well as the administrative, practical, down-to-earth, what kinds of projects can we do given the resources that we have that Mr. Racine represents. And I think one of the wonderful things that that we as curators and library directors and administrators really are blessed with is that we are able to focus on both of those, both the content, the academic content, the intellectual content, and the administrative tasks that are involved, sure that content is accessible and meaningful and useful. Questions to either of or both of our speakers? Who can? Can we get the microphone over to Sharon?
Hi, thank you very much. I have a question for Professor Reiner. You might have an ideological construct of a national library where it should represent all the minorities that live within the boundaries of the geographical space. The question is, how do you encourage groups who don't want to see themselves as part of the national identity, how do you encourage them to be part of creating or placing their memory within this larger collective who they have a problem seeing themselves as part of? So in that sense, it's really a way of encouraging recording and collecting, which also encourages memory and narrative, but within an area where they feel uncomfortable or a difficult space. How do we navigate that?
Thank you very much. It's a very important question. And this is part of our job. This is a job of the education department of the library. They made a great work among all the minorities in Israel, even also in the Israeli society, Jewish society also. Haredim, for example, are a sort of minority from this respect. And I think that one of the most important things that we are doing is to work with the great, what I call the big Arab minority. There is a department that deals with that, and you can see here in the library. First of all, you pointed out exactly the problem, and we have a problem with that, but we deal with it. This is our job as National Library, even if it's difficult or not. So there is a curator, one of the curators, not curator, one of the very important figure in the staff of the library that works specially with this minority, with the Arab minorities. And she did a lot of work and excellent. And you can come almost every day to the library to see classes of Palestinian children come and learn and look at the library, but there are, I agree, a lot of other classes that are not coming yet. At the end, if we speak about national, we have to look at it not as a nationalism, not as ideology, but as a definition. That's the reason that I insist on saying about the boundaries. If we look at it as the boundaries, so we collect the treasures, the culture, all the people that live here, at the end, everybody will understand that that's his area, that is place, and this is a treasury of all the cultures of the of this part of the of Eretz Israel.
It has been a fantastic 3 days. I want to thank everybody who came from near and far, who participated, our chairs, our panelists, our speakers, the people who asked questions, for making this what has been, to my mind, a really successful and an outstanding 3 days. And I'm looking forward to the next time that we're able to do this, God willing, in a few years. The bus will be leaving back to the hotel at 3:30.